Hey, 42 here. We live in the era of the celebrity, where fame and fortune seem to be valued just as highly as skill and learning. This is a time when TV personalities can suddenly find themselves leading nations, where Hollywood A-listers are rolled out by advertisers to brainwash the masses into buying things they don't need, and where being famous has, perplexingly, become a job in and of itself. But of course, the idea of celebrity is nothing new. In ancient Rome, gladiators were worshipped by frenzied crowds, baying for blood. Medieval saints, the influencers of their day, attracted followers by the millions. And royal scandal was discussed in alehouses and coffee shops around the world. In the history of our species, perhaps millions of celebrities have lived and died. But amongst these multitudes, there exists a small and very select subgroup that isn't often talked about. A kind of famous person VIP club that almost seems to defy the very meaning of what it is to be a celebrity in the first place. Members of this group have somehow managed to pull off a genuinely remarkable trick. Despite being household names to literally hundreds of millions of people around the world, nobody actually knows who they are. That might sound like an odd contradiction, but you'll be familiar with a few of them. Jack the Ripper terrorized the streets of London in the late 19th century, and yet nobody is quite sure who he really was. And Banksy is one of the most famous artists alive today, even though his real identity remains unconfirmed. But possibly the true OG of the known but unknown subcategory of celebrity is the subject of today's video. The Man in the Iron Mask. A historical figure whose true identity has routinely baffled generation after generation for a good 3.5 centuries. The story of the Man in the Iron Mask is one of political intrigue, dangerous secrets, and creative dungeon modifications, the details of which have been obfuscated over the years by a healthy dose of creative license from some of France's most celebrated citizens, including Alexandre Dumas and Voltaire. Our tale begins with a letter written by King Louis XIV, Secretary of State for War, in July of 1669. The letter was sent to a man by the name of Benigne Duverna de Saint-Mons, and it gave notice of the imminent arrival of a new prisoner at the fortress prison he presided over. Being a prison governor, Saint-Mons was used to these kinds of letters, but this one was a little different. Along with the standard information, it went on to outline certain unusual requirements, detailing how this particular prisoner should be housed. Requirements that made it abundantly clear this was to be no ordinary inmate. Saint-Mons was instructed to prepare a special cell with multiple doors set one after each other, like some kind of medieval airlock. This multi-door system would have made the cell a little more secure, but that wasn't the real purpose behind the modification. The unique extra doors setup wasn't designed to keep the prisoner from getting out. It was there to keep whatever dangerous secrets he knew in. The doors were essentially a kind of primitive soundproofing to ensure nobody outside of the cell could hear the prisoner talking from within. Saint-Mons was to be the only person ever to have contact with the prisoner, and even then, only once per day, in order to bring him food and water. The governor was also ordered that, should the prisoner utter a single word that wasn't directly related to an urgent personal need, he was to be executed on sight. The mysterious prisoner was kept under these unprecedented conditions for the next 30 years or so. A prison sentence long enough to secure him a spot on Wikipedia's longest prison sentences ever served page, by the way. During that time, the king's desire that nobody apart from San Mars should ever have contact with the prisoner was so strong that as San Mars's career progressed and he was promoted to the position of governor of a string of prominent prisons around France, his prisoner went along with him. And at each one of these institutions, a new multi-door cell was built for the prisoner, whose very existence continued to be shrouded in the utmost secrecy. By the way, if you're wondering why I haven't mentioned a certain iron mask up until this point, there's a very good reason for that. Our mysterious prisoner probably never wore one. He was forced to wear a mask made of black velvet, though, but even then, it's possible this slightly less cumbersome facial attire was only used as a precaution when the prisoner was moved between dungeons. But, you know, the man in the luxurious velvet facial covering doesn't quite have the same ring to it. As for why the prisoner is often depicted with his head encased in a block of metal, oddly enough, we have the French writer and philosopher Voltaire to thank for that. As you may know, Voltaire was rather ahead of his time when it came to things like free speech, freedom of religion, civil liberties, and lots of other things that didn't seem to go down too well with the authorities in 18th century France. And on that theme, in 1717, he joked that Philippe II, Duke of Orleans, was more than a little bit fond of having sex with his own daughter. This particular bit of friendly, incest-related banter was so hilarious that Voltaire was immediately thrown into France's most notorious prison, the Bastille. And it was there, no doubt rethinking the tone of his next stand-up routine, that Voltaire first heard whispers of an unusual prisoner who died in the prison a little more than 10 years earlier. Rumour had it that this prisoner, as I'm sure you've already guessed, had been kept in the strictest of seclusion by the prison's newly installed governor, one Benin Duverne de Saint-Mars. Whether Voltaire's new chums made up the bit about the iron mask, or black velvet somehow morphed into iron through a game of medieval Chinese whispers played between prison cells, isn't clear. Who knows, maybe Voltaire added that detail just to spice things up a bit. Whatever the truth, from that point on, the legend of the man in the iron mask was born. Incidentally, Voltaire also had a theory about who exactly this unnamed prisoner might have been, and why he'd been made to hide his face behind a mask. You see, it was rumoured amongst the older inmates that this mysterious prisoner was forced to wear a mask for one very simple reason. He was the spitting image of the King of France himself, Louis XIV. According to Voltaire, that family resemblance was more than an unfortunate coincidence. He believed the man in the iron mask was the illegitimate half-brother of the king himself. I should point out it isn't exactly clear how much of all this Voltaire might have made up in order to get back at the establishment who'd so recently imprisoned him. As we've seen, he wasn't averse to throwing shade when the mood took him. But the dates do add up. He was held in the Bastille not long after the man in the iron mask, so it's perfectly possible there was some truth to his claim. Either way, it certainly captured the imagination of the public in France, because over the years, the idea that man in the iron mask was somehow related to King Louis XIV took root, eventually making its way, slightly modified, into a novel by literary legend Alexandre Dumas. According to Dumas' version of events, the man in the iron mask was no mere illegitimate half-brother, but Louis XIV's identical twin and potential one true king of France, hidden from the public in order to simplify the family's rule. And if that version of events sounds familiar to you, you may well have seen the 1998 film starring Leonardo DiCaprio. because the plot very loosely follows Dumas' idea from around 150 years earlier. So, did either Voltaire or Dumas have it right? Well, it's impossible to say for sure, but it does seem pretty unlikely. Whilst both theories certainly would go a long way to explaining the extraordinary circumstances in which the prisoner was kept, long-lost brothers have always been a bit of an issue for kings, the problem is they both lack one quite important element of any good theory. Evidence. Like, any of it. So, if not a long-lost heir to the throne, who else might the faceless prisoner have been? Most of what we know about the man in the iron mask today comes from letters sent between his jailer, Saint-Mars, and various people in Louis XIV's court. These papers were rediscovered in 2015 after having been lost at some point in the previous century or so. And when modern scholars got their hands on them, they found some pretty remarkable clues as to the real identity of the man in the iron mask. And when I say clues, I actually mean his full name and occupation, Eustache Duger, valet. For a little while, it seemed like this new information had finally solved the mystery of the man in the iron mask once and for all. But then things started to get complicated. Historians quickly tracked down records of a man by the name of Eustache Duger, who was alive in France at about the right time. And the more they found out about this long-dead Frenchman, the more excited they got. Not much is known about Duger's early life, but in 1659, he got himself embroiled in a national scandal in France, known as the Affair of the Poisons, in which hundreds of people, including several members of the aristocracy, and even Louis XIV's favourite mistress, were accused of poisoning and witchcraft. So far, so promising. A man by the right name was involved in a scandal which would have been highly embarrassing to the king himself. But here's where things start to fall down. There's no indication that this particular Eustache Duger ever worked as a valet. And more importantly, why go to such an insane amount of trouble for one man? Why design and build modified prison cells for him and put all those other special measures in place? Why assign a single prison governor to spend his entire career looking after him? Why force him to wear a velvet mask to hide his face? Why have vanilla ice cream when you can have mint choc chip? Why do any of these things? To put some context around these questions, well, all except the ice cream one, there were almost 450 people involved in the Affair of the Poisons. Dozens were executed for their crimes, and dozens more were exiled or imprisoned. Why keep one apparently random member of the scandal in impossibly secretive conditions for almost 30 years? Even if Eustache Duger really had known some terrible secret about the king's mistress, for example, Louis XIV was one of the most important men in the entire world at the time. He would go on to rule France for 72 years, making him the longest ruling monarch of a sovereign country in history, a record that still stands today. If Louis had wanted to discreetly kill off someone who could have proved to be an embarrassment, he could have done so as easily as breaking wind. No. To find a theory that better explains why the man in the iron mask was allowed to live so long, when all evidence suggests he was in possession of some truly incendiary information, we can look towards another popular theory. That the man in the iron mask was actually Louis XIV's biological father. According to this one, Louis XIV was not the son of his predecessor, the imaginatively named Louis XIII, but another unnamed man. And to be fair, the circumstances around Louis XIV's birth are a little fishy. He was born some 23 years after his parents were first married, which is already somewhat unusual for royal families keen on pumping out viable heirs as fast as queenly wombs can brew them, which is why, when Louis XIV arrived on the scene in 1638, The birth was widely considered to be a miracle sent straight from God. Oh, and I should probably mention that plenty of historians believe Louis XIII may actually have been a homosexual. Take all of this together, and it isn't beyond the realms of possibility that an unknown penis of some description made an appearance during the making of Louis XIV. If true, this theory would do a magnificent job of explaining why the man in the iron mask was kept under such extraordinary conditions. His very existence represented a secret that would have threatened to topple the entire French monarchy. And at the same time, the king may well have been reluctant to have his own father murdered, even if it did mean burying an embarrassing secret. Which would neatly explain why the man in the iron mask was kept alive for so long. The theory fits the picture perfectly, hence why it's popular. And yet, sadly, there's not a single shred of evidence to support it. It's a theory not based on evidence, but on circumstance. And herein lies the problem with pretty much every single man in the iron mask suspect that's ever been put forward in the last 300 plus years. Not a single one of them has provided that magic combination of plausibility and evidence. Which is why it's no great exaggeration to say that, as of today, despite scores of scholars and writers who've dedicated hefty portions of their careers to uncovering the real face behind the mask, we aren't really any closer to knowing the truth. Of course, the great irony of this whole story is that, in trying so hard to keep the identity of the man in the iron mask a secret, King Louis XIV and co. have, in some ways, made him one of the most famous prisoners who ever lived. Thanks for watching. Check out my new podcast, Random Interesting Facts, available on YouTube, Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and anywhere else you get your podcasts. Link in the description below. Thanks.